now from the CFTK-TV studios, this is Open Connection, brought to you by Rio Tinto Elcan.
Thank you for staying with us. Today we are discussing the seriousness of domestic violence and violence against women. Joining you right now is the Ending Violence Association's Morgan Baldwin. And this is such a huge topic, and I know I've said that quite a lot, but there is so much to discuss. One thing is victims, if you're a friend, and if you friend or family member, how do you know if maybe your friend or family member is going through this? How can you tell?
One of the biggest things to watch out for is the isolation. If you, all of a sudden you're not seeing your friend as much, it may be that, you know, their partner's not allowing them to have contact with you. They may be embarrassed or ashamed, but it's a really important piece to watch for, the isolation. And if you're finding that you're losing touch with your friend, it may be when people are in new relationships, sometimes they do isolate themselves with their new loved one, but it's a really important warning sign to watch out for, and also something that people can do something about if their friend is becoming isolated.
Mm-hmm. And what can a friend or family member do so they're not pushing that victim away and making it so they know that they're there to help?
Just saying exactly that, and making sure, because there is a lot of shaming and judging of people who are victimized, making sure that they're not part of that problem. So, you know, just letting their friend or family member know that it's not their fault and there is help and nobody deserves to be abused and it's not their behavior that's causing their partner to be abusive or violent toward them, and staying away from, you know, trying to fix that person. Really, what your job is as a friend or family member is to help build their self-esteem and to help them understand that you're there for them when they're dealing with a situation where their self-esteem is being devastated by what they're dealing with.
Now, for the abusers, or which is typically men or males, what services are out there for them to access?
Well, it's important to know that you can stop being abusive and that you can seek counseling. It's not an anger management problem. Because generally people who are abusive to their partner in very intentional ways. They're not generally, you know, punching out their boss, or they can control their anger in certain situations. So finding a counselor who can help you stop your use of violence, and knowing that you can be nonviolent in your relationship and have a great healthy family, you're completely in control of changing that. But really finding somebody who can help you look at why are you being abusive and give you some tools to stop being abusive, and also to give you tools for something that we don't learn a lot about, which is how to be a healthy partner in a relationship, and how to be a lot of what they do in the programs as well. What counselors will do is help with parenting.
What is the likelihood for the man to be the victim?
It's, well, what we know about is predominantly that it's a crime of male violence against women, which doesn't mean that men don't experience violence in their relationships, but predominantly it's when they are what we call the primary aggressor. So they're the ones who are using all of these tactics to gain and maintain power and control in their relationship. And victims will often fight back and retaliate. And so that's like the largest group of men who are experiencing violence in their relationships are men who are experiencing it from their partners who they're being abusive toward. It's not to say that men aren't the primary victims sometimes, but we just don't see it very much. And it's hard to tell. There's a lot of discussion about statistics and what they mean and whether people report and whether they don't report. But that's when we look at domestic violence homicides, it's really a pretty compelling picture.
Mm-hmm. So for example, if a woman does leave the situation and the abuser doesn't seek help afterwards, is there a problem with that person to maybe continue the violence with another victim?
Yeah, there always is. We see that where if people work in a community for a number of years, they'll end up supporting one victim after another from the same person if they haven't gotten some help to end their use of violence in relationships. And it's really quite sad, because most often the victims in the relationship do everything they can and really take it on that it was something that they did that was causing that, when we know it's really about the person who's being violent and abusive and their need to get some support to stop that.
And we were talking earlier about victim blaming. How much of an issue is that actually here in the province of BC?
It's a huge problem, and you can see whenever there's any kind of media about domestic violence, or particularly domestic violence homicides, there's very rarely questions asked about why somebody would injure or kill their partners. The first question is always about her in the scenario where the woman is the victim. Why did she pick him? Why didn't she just leave? All of those kinds of things. So there's a lot in terms of the public response. There's a lot in terms of friends and family and neighbors blaming the victim, and a lot of, I think, a lot of reasons for that. One of them being just natural that we want to think that if we were in that situation, we would do something differently and it wouldn't happen to us, and we would react differently than that victim. And it's really damaging. It's really incorrect, but it's also really damaging to people who are being bullied and blamed and shamed in their relationships, and then experiencing that in larger society as well.
Stay with us, and after the break, we're going to be talking more about the Ending Violence Association.
Open Connection will be right back after these messages.